This is a true story. Dramatizations are derived from eyewitness testimony and second-hand accounts.
Millions of liters of water burst into a mine shaft. 18 miners are trapped deep underground.
You're just sitting, thinking, you know, you're actually gonna die in here.
Engineers have only one shot at a rescue.
You're either gonna be a hero or zero, one or the other.
If they get it wrong, they will kill the men they are trying to save. United States, Pennsylvania, Somerset County. Somerset is coal mining country. At the Quecreek Mine, 18 men arrive for the evening shift. Among them is veteran miner Ron Shad.
We were close, we were a good crew. I knew those guys, I worked with them. I mean, I spent 50% of my days with them.
It's daily routine for the men to break into two teams of nine. 41-year-old Mark Popanak has been a miner for half his life and enjoys the camaraderie.
It's usually fun, crazy, you know, guys joking around until it's time to go underground.
Quecreek is one of nine mines in Somerset County alone, whose miners produce over 2 million tons of coal a year. Many of them love their work, but it's a dangerous profession. Since 1970, on average, 180 American miners are killed each year doing their job. Structural collapses underground cause most fatalities.
Hey, you guys better lay off.
On the wall of the office is the Quecreek mine map. It shows the two crews where they'll be working in the mine today. The Quecreek mine is 2 years old. It stretches for 2.5 kilometers into the Pennsylvania countryside. Older mines are also scattered throughout the hills. Closest is Saxman Mine, which has been abandoned for over 40 years. Mark Popanak drives his team into the mine on a battery-powered vehicle called a man trip. It's a 40-minute journey to the shafts. Ron Shad's crew soon follows. The roof quickly lowers to just 1.5 meters high, and the light disappears.
It's dark. Somebody hits you in the face, you won't see stars. I mean, that's it, it's dark. That's absolute darkness.
The mine shaft is made up of a series of tunnels. 900 meters into the journey, the shaft splits in two. Ron Shad and his crew of eight miners travel south into the shaft of tunnels called mains. At the coalface, they get to work. Meanwhile, over half a kilometer away, Popanak and his team work a tunnel in another shaft, called First Left. Here, they use a 60-ton machine which bears 100 teeth of hardened carbon steel. It can chew out 20 tons of coal every minute. According to the maps, there should be 91 meters of coal separating Popanak's team from the old Saxman mine. But the plans he is working to are wrong. The Saxman mine is just meters away. And on the other side is almost a quarter of a billion liters of stagnant water that has gathered over 40 years. For the rest of his shift, he continues to dig.
Coming on 9 o'clock, you try and looking forward to quitting time and 11 o'clock, time to go.
We got water!
Go!
He can't believe what he sees.
Go!
20 meters in front of him, a wall of water explodes into the shaft.
There was no trickling, there was instant water. Big time. That it's just a wall of water. You have a 60-ton machine there, and it's just coming around it, through it, over it, like it's not there.
Popanak has a split second to act. He jumps into a chamber to the side, which saves his life. Raging water is just inches away.
You stand beside a railroad track with a freight train coming by you 100 miles an hour, it's probably louder than that.
He's closest to the turret. But he's not the miner in most danger. Gravity dictates that water always heads to the lowest point. The deepest part of the mine are the tunnels in the main shaft, just over half a kilometer away. Ron Shad and his team are oblivious to the tsunami heading their way. Luckily, the team at first left is able to make a call to Shad and colleagues on the surface.
I went and answered the phone. They were yelling that we hit water, you gotta get out, you gotta get out.
Go! Go, Larry, get there.
Shad gets word to the rest of the crew scattered in mains. Then takes off.
That looks like we're going home early today.
None of his colleagues realizes the seriousness of the situation.
Where's this water at that they're talking about? I was joking coming out. All right, we get an early quit, you know.
The seven men make their way steadily to the exit. Up ahead, Shad grabs fellow miner Larry Somerville, jumps on a golf cart, and races to the surface.
Where the hell's coming from? Let's get the hell out of here.
And he hurried up and got on, and he's right, what's the matter? What's going on? I told him to hit water. We have to get out.
They have only one choice, to drive back along the main shaft, past the junction with First Left, to the mine entrance. Up ahead, Shad and Somerville approach the junction with First Left.
I don't know where. Let's get the other guys and get the hell out of here.
They are stunned by what they see. The dip where the two mine shafts intersect is already flooded ceiling high.
All we saw was water to the roof. It was full. That was our way out. I knew he was in trouble. I mean, I thought this was going to be it.
Shad is desperate. Then he remembers there is one possible way out. On the side of the shaft is a self-contained ventilation tunnel, sealed with concrete blocks. There is a chance this could still be dry. They search for a door into the vent.
I backed up the golf cart back to where the door was and turned it towards the door and left the light on, so they knew which direction we went.
They step into the unknown. They're relieved to find that the ventilation tunnel is dry. The two men crawl as fast as they can towards the surface, 1.5 kilometers away. The other seven miners from Shad's group soon discover what he already knows. The main exit is blocked. They haven't considered the ventilation tunnel. Doug Custer feels doomed.
Our escape was gone. You're thinking, I'm a dead duck.
They've no choice but to back up away from the rising water. Then Custer spots the clue left by Ron Shad.
We saw their golf cart, you know, right there at the door, so we knew that they went out the intake.
Shad has given them a chance. Custer and his colleagues start to make their way uphill along the ventilation tunnel out of the mine. At First Left, Hope is fading fast for the other team. They don't have access to a ventilation tunnel. Mark Popanak is separated from his eight workmates by a raging torrent of water. He's running out of time.
This whole time, I'm praying to God to give me the strength to get myself across this water, because I knew if I didn't, I was going to die.
Over 500 yards away, Custer's team continues up the ventilation tunnel.
We heard something boom.
A door bursts open under the enormous pressure.
The water's gushing, it's roaring, it sounded like Niagara Falls.
Their escape tunnel is now a whirlpool. If the men don't battle their way out, they could drown. A quarter of a billion liters of water is pouring into the Quecreek Mine. 18 miners struggle to find a way out. Seven are trapped in a flooded ventilation tunnel. Doug Custer knows their only hope is to battle through the torrent.
Give it a shot. It's our last chance. If we don't make it, we're in other hands.
Up ahead, the ventilation tunnel is still dry. Ron Shad has covered hundreds of meters on his hands and knees. He can hear water gushing below him. He must stay ahead of the rising flood.
My heart was pumping a mile a minute. I didn't stop too long because I didn't know how fast the water was coming. I figured if I pass out or have a heart attack, it's better than drowning.
He battles his way towards the surface. Finally, he sees the exit.
I knew then that, you know, I made it. I was out. And I was so worried that, you know, my buddies didn't make it.
9:35 p.m., 40 minutes after the breach. The mine office turns into the command center for a rescue operation. Mine owner Dave Reebuck and his men study plans of Quecreek Mine. They quickly realize the water must be coming from the abandoned Saxman Mine. They know Saxman holds a quarter of a billion liters of water. That's enough to completely fill the Quecreek Mine, floor to ceiling. Outside the mine, Ron Shad is desperately worried. None of his colleagues has emerged.
So I'm looking. Finally, I saw some lights coming, and I had no idea how many. It just, you can see glitters coming.
Eight miners from Mainz have battled through the water to safety.
Love to see your ugly face.
It was a real good feeling, you know, to know that they made it out also.
But the moment of jubilation is short-lived. Their nine colleagues from First Left are still missing.
All of us really wondered where the other crew was. That was what we was thinking of then. Where's the rest of the guys?
The men are trapped here at First Left. Mark Popanak is still separated from the other eight by a raging river. He knows time is running out. He signals to his colleagues to forget about trying to rescue him and to save themselves.
If you just move your head like that, it would mean to go, because I knew there was no possible way for me to get across this water. The amount of water that was coming in there, I knew this mine is filling up very, very quick. And they don't have time to wait around and try to get me, because if they would have done so, we would all die.
Reluctantly, Popanak's colleagues leave him. They battle towards the exit along a conveyor belt above the rising water. But the torrent overwhelms them. They are trapped in a mine shaft filling fast. ...97 kilometers away, Joe Spafoni gets a call at home. He works for the Pennsylvania Bureau of Deep Mine Safety.
9:30 was when I received the phone call, who told me that they had 18 men underground, 9 had made it out, 9 were trapped. When you hear something like that, you know, your heart goes into your stomach.
Spafoni and Reebok immediately agree on one thing. If there are survivors, they will have to find high ground. The highest point in that section is at the end of First Left, where the breach has taken place. Spafoni must find out if any miners are taking refuge here.
It was a very, very dire situation, and I knew that if anybody did survive, we had to try to communicate with them.
They decide to try and drill a 15-centimeter hole, 75 meters down, into First Left. Maybe, using a video camera and microphone, they can communicate with any survivors. While Spafoni formulates his plans, the police inform the families of what has happened to their loved ones. Sandy Popanak is in bed when she hears something downstairs.
And I hear this voice come in. He said, "Is somebody up there?" And I said, "Yes, who's down there?" And they said, "It's the state police. I need to talk to you for a minute." Almost collapsed, because they really couldn't tell me anything other than that there was an accident.
Sandy Popanak rushes with the other families to the local fire hall to wait for more news. 1 a.m. Water has almost completely filled the mine. The miners realize they can't get out. They must head to the highest point of First Left. This will be close to where the flood first broke through 4 hours earlier. Mark Popanak remains trapped one side of the breach at First Left. Water is now up to his waist. He must free himself.
Caught my breath, calmed down, told myself I gotta think of something to do here.
Desperate times call for desperate measures.
You know, I looked up and I seen these J hooks, which are little hooks that you hang on roof plates to hang cables on. I thought, maybe I can monkey on these roof plates. So I went to the toolbox and got these J hooks, and I was just testing it to see if I could actually accomplish this. And I could. I mean, it was difficult, and I thought, well, I'm gonna die doing this, but I'm at least gonna try.
As Popanak prepares to suspend himself onto the roof plates, something stops him.
A light shined through a hole in this wall. I seen it was John. If he'd have been 30 seconds later, I probably would have attempted this crazy monkey business I invented, and probably would have been washed away.
Popanak's fellow miners are determined to free him. They back a mechanical digger with a large scoop bucket into the raging torrent. Popanak knows exactly what he has to do.
Well, this is do or die here, because I knew I had to jump, and if I missed the scoop bucket, I was gonna go down the river, no doubt about it.
Popanak takes a moment, then launches himself to his fate.
But when I looked at their faces, I thought, yeah, what's wrong with you guys, you know?
What Popanak doesn't realize is that he and his colleagues are still trapped.
I didn't realize what they just went through. I didn't realize there was no way out. You know, they made their attempt to get out, and it didn't work.
Unless the rescuers can think of something, Popanak and his colleagues are standing in a watery grave. In the mine office, the rescue operation is struggling. It's 1:30 a.m., and the miners have been underground for almost 11 hours. They don't know if any are alive. They figure that any survivors will have headed to the high ground in First Left. To find out, they decide to drill a small hole into that section. To pinpoint the position above ground where they need to drill, they turn to surveyor Sean Isgen.
walk into the trailer.
Good, Sean. Yourself? Good, Dave.
Mind map was on the wall, and they pointed to a location on the map and told us that we needed to go stake that location in a field while they were getting the drill rig lined up to come in and drill the test hole.
Okay, let me run some numbers here for you.
Isgun sets off into the night. Using mine survey data, he has to calculate the exact spot to drill. He sets to work with an assistant and a GPS.
He'd read the coordinates and it would say, well, you know, move 2 feet north and a foot east, and we would do that. And then it would say, you know, move 6 inches north and 1 inch east, and we would do that.
That's our spot.
And literally took a wood stake and pounded a stake in the ground, tied a ribbon around it and said, drill here.
At 2:50 a.m., the drill pierces the ground. It will take at least 2 hours to break through 75 meters of earth. The drill bit is rotated by a diesel engine and hammered into the ground by blasts of air from a compressor on the surface. Sean Isgun is aiming the drill bit at the heart of a channel just 6 meters wide. If the data he is working to is wrong, then the drill bit will miss the mine shaft and chew straight into solid coal. They'd have to drill again, taking 2 more hours. It is time they simply do not have. 3 a.m. Water has been gushing into the mine for more than 6 hours. It is getting so close to the miners that they believe it will engulf them in a matter of hours. In desperation, they start building a barricade using concrete blocks. But they now face a new threat. Air quality in the mine is deteriorating. They are starting to suffocate.
Everybody's exhausted, very tired, and it was hard to do anything. You know, I don't know what a 4-inch cement block is, maybe 10 or 12 pounds, it felt like it was 50 pounds. We continued working, you know, at our, you know, whatever pace we could.
Above ground, Joe Spafoni knows for the miners to have any chance, he must tackle the flood. He arranges for pumps to be carried into the mine to pump out millions of liters of water. But it's a hopeless task.
As fast as they would get pumps set up, the water would overtake the pumps. It was just too much water.
The miners' families have been waiting all night. Mark Popanak's wife starts to contemplate worst-case scenario.
I thought, what am I going to do? What am I going to do if my husband doesn't come out of there alive?
Below, Popanak and his crew are losing hope. Then, they hear something.
And I believe while we were building the first wall, we heard this drill start to come far, far away. Just barely hear.
At 4:10 a.m., the miners can hear the drill bit getting close. With oxygen running out, they are struggling to breathe.
You'd hear them drill and you hear them drill, and it's getting louder and louder and louder. And, you know, it's really close. You know, I think everybody stopped working, and you're trying to figure out where it's going to come through at.
Then, at 5 a.m., the drill bit reaches 75 meters. Above ground, the rescue team is nervous. To have any chance of rescuing the miners, they must first find them. They pray that the drill will locate them alive in first left. 5:06 a.m., 8 hours after the breach.
Everybody's staying back out of the way. And it's coming. All of a sudden, this drill bit comes through the roof. And everybody started to feel, at least I did, started to feel better because you're getting some oxygen.
The miners feel better because the compressor powering the drill blasts fresh air into the mine.
They are desperate to tell the outside world they're alive. Popanak takes off his helmet and looks at a label inside. It tells them how to signal to the surface in the event of a cave-in. On the surface, above the howling of the drill, Joe Spafoni thinks he hears something.
I could have swore I heard somebody beat on the drill. And I looked at the driller and I asked him, I said, Lou, I thought I heard something. He said, so did I. I said, shut the compressor off.
All equipment is turned off. Silence descends on the site. Spafoni must confirm they are alive. Below ground, the miners respond.
I guess that was obviously a joyous moment on the surface because they knew we were alive.
There is huge relief. Escaped miner Ron Shad is working the water pumps when he hears the news.
Everybody just start cheering. And it was something.
But the celebration is short-lived. They still don't know how to get the miners out. And the men trapped below are about to face a new threat, as deadly as the rising floodwaters. Engineers have successfully guided a 15-centimeter drill bit into the heart of Quecreek Mine. But the water in the mine is still rising. They calculate they have an hour before the shaft is completely flooded and the men drowned. Engineer Joe Spafoni knows there is only one option. To drill another hole, large enough to pull out the trapped men. Where can they find a drill big enough? There is nothing on site. They hit the phones. And finally find one at a gas well, 188 kilometers away in West Virginia. At 5:30 a.m., 8.5 hours into the flood, the massive drill starts its journey towards Quecreek. The best estimate is it will take 9 hours to reach the mine. Time the miners do not have. Now the rescuers discover that the trapped men face a deadly new threat. The hole into the shaft allows Spafoni to test the air quality below ground. The results shock him.
We took an air reading and had low oxygen on the surface and assumed that the air in the mine was much worse.
Fresh air contains 21% oxygen. Anything less is potentially lethal. Spafoni calls a ventilation expert to confirm his results.
Well, we were able to measure the oxygen concentration and we knew it was around 17%.
17% is dangerously low. The miners will pass out and, in a matter of hours, suffocate.
We were afraid they're not going to be able to survive in that.
Jurasek realizes they have an air supply at hand from the compressors that power the drill. Immediately, he orders the men to turn the drill compressors back on and to pump air through the drill hole to the miners. The air will keep them alive, but it puts an end to all communications with the trapped men. Now both miner and rescuer must work in the dark. Sandy Popanak and other relatives are taken to the site. When she sees the communication hole sealed up, she panics.
And I saw that they had put the pipe down, and I remember I kind of lost it, I guess, at that point. And the gentleman that put the pipe down came over and explained to me exactly what was going on. So that kind of relieved me to know that maybe they were possibly getting some air down through there.
The air may be keeping them alive, only for the water to kill them. The water level is rising at 7 meters every hour.
We knew if it continued to go at that rate, we only had about an hour to do something, or it would flood them.
Jurasek and his colleagues need thinking time. They must come up with an answer, and fast.
I remember being on the porch, and we're just sitting there looking out in the dark. And it's like, what are we going to do? If we don't come up with something, these miners, they're going to perish.
Suddenly, Jurasek is struck by an idea. They might be able to use the air compressor to do more than provide oxygen to the miners. If they can pump enough air into the small dry space at first left, it will create a pressurized air pocket or a bubble. If the air pressure is high enough, it may hold back the rising waters. It's high risk, unorthodox, and has never been attempted before in the US.
Everything had to be just right, and there were a lot of unknowns at that time.
They calculate they will need to pump 950 cubic feet of air per minute at 90 pounds per square inch into first left. Just after 5 a.m., 9 hours into the flood, the compressor is set to maximum. But conditions in first left are getting worse. The water is now just 25 meters from the nine miners and rising. The men prepare themselves.
And I remember Blaine asking Randy for a pen, but he wanted to write a note to his family. And he tore off a piece of cardboard from a resin box.
They do not expect to see their families again.
We took turns with the pen, and we put them in a bucket and sealed that bucket up. And that was it.
The miners know that when the time comes and they drown, their bodies could float away and be lost in the maze of tunnels. Some of them choose to tie themselves together, but not all.
I didn't want to do that because I wasn't ready to give up yet. I knew I was going to drown, but I figured I'm not going to give up till that last second.
Above ground, surveyor Sean Isgun continues to find locations for the water pumps that are delivered to the site. Alarmingly, the mine is now so flooded that water is pouring out of the entrance.
Look down in that, and it was literally a lake. And you just think, oh my gosh, how are we gonna do this?
But underground, Popanak begins to suspect that the tide, quite literally, is turning. The water is rising at a much lower rate. He knows external forces are at work.
Now, we had the water jugs with us, and they were starting to collapse, the pressure. So we knew, you know, that we were actually under pressure, sort of like being in a submarine.
A pressurized pocket of air is acting like a dam, holding the water back from the miners. The question is, how long can a bubble repel millions of liters of water? The 30-inch carbide drill bit is unloaded from the truck as John Hamilton supervises. With the news cameras focusing on him, he feels the pressure.
I said, if we drill in and these miners, for some odd reason, didn't survive, I said, they're going to point their finger at us because we took so long in the drill bit. I mean, you're either going to be a hero or zero, one or the other.
At 6 p.m., 21 hours after the breach, drilling begins on the rescue shaft. 45 minutes later, Mark Schweiker, the governor of Pennsylvania, arrives at the site. The governor is briefed on the situation. He is the one person with the power to give the rescuers anything they need.
I asked to be given a complete feel for what the miners were experiencing and seeing down below to the kind of trials and impediments that we would face.
Within hours, Governor Schweiker is having an impact on the rescue.
We were bringing in equipment and miners from all over. We had three or four different drilling companies, and we're bringing in just enormous pumps that are being flown in from all over the country.
We had an air compressor would break down. We'd take the lines off of it, put it right on another, and keep on going. It was sitting right there.
But as the hours go by, there's more bad news. The water levels in the mine are still very high. The water is pressing hard against the protective air pocket. If the rescue shaft bursts the air bubble when it breaks through, the floodwater will flow back and drown the miners instantly. The water level must be reduced, but so far, the pumps aren't making any impact. Governor Schweiker must decide whether they should carry on digging the rescue shaft.
I realized that my job was to consider the best counsel given me by some very intelligent people. The best decision was to forge ahead. Probably we didn't have much more time.
Drilling of the shaft has been going on for just 3 hours, and nothing has been heard of the miners for six. The media is impatient for news. Schweiker puts on a brave face.
So it's time for hope and hard labor. And I believe it's perfectly realistic to remain confident.
Meanwhile, 75 meters below ground, and with the water still gaining on them, the nine miners hear something.
All of a sudden, we heard this other drill start to drill. And another good feeling, of course, because, they got to drill this hole to get us out of here, because I can't imagine them pumping all this water out of this coal mine, because I know there's a lot of water.
1:12 a.m. on the third day, 28 hours into the crisis. John Hamilton has been working on the rescue shaft for 6 hours when he notices a problem with the compressor that drives the drill.
When you lose air pressure, they won't do nothing. So, you know right away when something happens.
What Hamilton discovers is a disaster. Under the glare of the world's media, the drill bit has snapped off 32 meters down.
That bit should have drilled, at least 1,000 feet. It should have never broke, but they do break. And nobody can explain why or, point your fingers at who or what.
The rescue shaft is now blocked by a massive broken drill bit and useless. This could be the end for the miners. The trapped men realize something is wrong.
You could tell by the sound of this drill, it was much bigger. And it's grinding away, and all of a sudden it stops.
Something about that, we're going to lose the men.
Above ground, Governor Schweiker's feeling the strain.
We're going to get these guys out.
I probably, in quieter moments, was looking upward and saying, can you give us a break here?
He rushes to tell the families the news.
That was a very devastating moment. Everything's going along smooth. It's like anything else. Everything's going along smooth. Something breaks, it's devastating.
John Hamilton has more bad news for the governor. He will have to blindly fish the drill bit out of the hole. It's a tricky operation and usually takes days.
There's an awful chance you can't get that bit back out when you break it. Normally, in a situation like that, you'll fish on the thing 3 or 4 days or whatever if you can, cement the hole back up, move the rig over, and start a new one.
But they do not have 3 or 4 days. They need another drill bit. Governor Schweiker tells Hamilton to get one on site immediately.
Finally, I got a little aggravated at him, which I shouldn't have, and I said, hey, you just don't go to Walmart and pull this stuff off the shelf. These bits you plan way ahead, sometimes 6 months in advance to get one.
The rescue team must wait 4 hours for another drill bit to arrive. Then it must dig a second rescue shaft from scratch. Rather than wait, Hamilton tries to fish the broken drill bit out of the existing shaft. The media reports every move.
By 3:15 this afternoon, there was no drilling in progress at all, as they were still trying to retrieve the broken drill bit on number one hole and do preliminary work before drilling could begin on number two hole.
Friday, 4 p.m. The mine flood is 43 hours old. There are now 12 pumps operating at the site, removing up to 102,000 liters of water a minute. Finally, there is a glimmer of hope. The flow of stagnant water from Saxman Mine is slowing down, and at last the rescuers begin to have an impact on the water levels. A race is now on to remove as much water as possible. And there is more good news. Against all odds, after battling for 15 hours, John Hamilton snags the broken drill bit and fishes it out of the rescue shaft.
And it just seemed like nothing was going our way at first. And then when we got it out, that's when we knew things were going to turn around. Just for some odd reason, I don't know why. It just felt good.
Things are back on track. John Hamilton goes back to work on the existing rescue shaft with a new drill bit. He pushes on through the last 43 meters of earth. Saturday, 1:38 p.m. The miners have been underground for almost 3 days. Drilling at the rescue shaft has been going on for 13 hours. They make rapid progress and are now less than 6 meters from breaking through. But Hamilton is told to stop. The pumps still haven't lowered the water to a safe level. If they break through now, the air bubble will burst and the miners will drown.
Rescue.
Pumping must continue for at least 8 more hours. Can the rescuers afford to wait that long? There has been no communication with the miners for almost 2 full days. 9 miners have been trapped in Quecreek Mine for almost 65 hours. A rescue drill is less than 6 meters from cutting through, but drilling has stopped. The water levels are too high. If they break in now, the miners will drown. But can the rescuers afford to wait? A decision is needed.
Now, this decision was a very, very heavy decision. The miners going to be okay for another 8 hours.
Let's keep this in mind. This is a rescue.
The rescuers decide not to break through. They will wait for the water to lower.
That day was an extremely long day because we were all sitting around knowing, praying that what we had done had worked.
It is 8:58 on day 4. For 8 hours, the drill has been waiting to break through. The pumps have lowered the water level. If the air bubble has worked, the miners might still be alive. The moment has come to break through, but they still cannot be sure if it's safe.
We all kind of step back, so to speak, and realize that at that point, 70-some hours after they were trapped there, that the possibility of them dying anyway also existed. We didn't have much more time. And with that, we said, we go.
This is situation critical. The rescuers break through. In doing so, they may have just killed the miners. The steel drill is removed. They will now find out, once and for all, if their rescue mission has worked. Acoustics expert Bob Zaremski lowers his microphone into the hole. Finally, the microphone reaches the bottom of the shaft.
Once the microphone punched through, I did ask probably the
stupidest question of my life.
Are you the nine miners?
And this guy asked us if we were the nine trapped miners.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I take a good bit of ribbing anytime I see any of those guys.
Yeah, nobody else here but us miners, you know.
The cameras of the world's media capture Bob Zaremski giving the thumbs up. Nine alive.
I was up on the hillside and I was told that we did it and nine are alive. And that was a very emotional time for me.
The rescue team gently lowers a pod to the nine men. One by one, the miners climb into the pod and are lifted up into the glare of television cameras.
Screaming, hollering, yelling, clapping, it was all going on. I mean, it was just a very triumphant moment.
2:45 a.m. After 77 hours and 55 minutes trapped underground, Mark Popanak is the last person out.
Born again, I call it my second birthday.
The important lesson is you never give up. You always assume they're alive until you have a confirmation.
I think it speaks very well for our little country town out here that people just pull together. They just pulled together and they did whatever they could.
The rescue of the Quecreek miners is one of the most remarkable of modern times. It has provided emergency teams with tried and tested response procedures for rescuing people trapped underground.